Ambassador Sem Fabrizi, welcome to Hawke Talks.
It's a pleasure to be here, Anthony.
Ambassador, in the wake of the global financial crisis, the financial bailout of Greece, and now with Brexit looming, the EU in 2016 is facing huge challenges. I wonder what's your assessment of how the EU has been coping with and responding to these difficulties?
Well, Anthony, thank you for the question. I would say that is looking from an outside point of view, certainly we are not going through an easy period in Europe, but we have to remember that each of those challenges you made have their own dynamic, their own history, and you cannot just pile them up under a single framework. The difficulties we have on the global financial crisis are largely behind us. The economy is back on track. Both the Eurozone, so the 19 countries of which share the same currency, and the 28 are already growing since 2 years. Certainly, Greece is a country that needs special help, and the European Union member state and Commission are working on with the Greece very, very closely. Migration is a different story. It certainly is a humanitarian challenge that we are dealing with our rules, with the respect of the international law. And you made a reference to a referendum that we prefer to call UK in the EU rather than Brexit. At least this is our hashtag in Brussels. It's something that we are looking forward to see what the British people will decide.
We'll come to migration in a moment. You've made some of that sound perhaps a little less taxing than it might have been. I was just thinking that the crises are sketched out. A number of commentators have argued for years that the EU is a grand experiment. It's been an experiment in regional and global governance. I mean, just how far have these challenges really pressed the European Union to kind of rethink its basic coordinates, or do you think these have been challenges that have been relatively difficult, but business as usual?
There's a two story in Europe that is being said: never lose the opportunity of a good crisis. In the sense, the European Union has advanced through the last 60 decades, through different difficulties we had. And every time at the end of this crisis, the European Union was stronger, because always found the capacity to find an agreement, a compromise, and tackle the new challenges with new instruments. So from a positive point of view, you might see that those crises will make Europe stronger, because we have developed a new legislation, we have developed a new instrument to work together. At the same time, we should be realistic that certainly we are not in a business as usual times, because we have the combination of several external shocks. It's important to note that those crises are not originated within the European Union. The financial crisis moved from Wall Street to Brussels, was not originated by us, and the migration crisis is coming from the civil war in Syria, instability in Libya, instability in Yemen, instability in other part of the country. So the question is that this time is not business as usual, because we are faced with the big external shock, but we have to deal with. So my reply would be: Europe usually goes better and at the end of a crisis, because the new policies are developed. Certainly this time we are not in a business as usual mode. That's why an extraordinary effort is being requested to all of us.
On the topic of global shocks, arguably nowhere has that been more evident than in the current migration crisis. 2016 has seen many governments across the continent, some say, abdicating responsibility. Some have even argued that the EU now faces an ethical catastrophe of historic proportions. What's your response to the critics and the skeptics?
The critics have never been very generous with us. I think in 2010 they were talking about a collapse of the Eurozone. Greece and others would have left the Eurozone. If you're a little bit more sober and look at the facts, we see that in 2014-16 no one has left the Eurozone. Even we have a new member on January 2015, so the Eurozone is there, and the Eurozone is there to prosper and create the growth and opportunities. Migration certainly is a big issue. The UNHCR said that we have 60 million refugees, for one reason or another one, a large part of these displaced and refugees are around our borders. So we live in Europe from the eastern border to the southern border. We are facing a very important migration crisis. We are responding with our tool, which is based on European Union legislation and international legislation. So rather than saying the member state abdicating, as some critics suggest, I would say that Europe is not abdicating, because we are dealing with an unprecedented migration flow respecting our law. Certainly it's difficult to manage 1.2 million migrants as Europe managed in 2015, respecting the EU and international law, but we did it, and we are putting in play, but it's a situation certainly is not sustainable in the future. So that's why we're putting together a series of measures to help the origin country, the transit countries, and the countries of European Union who ensure the border of Europe to manage the flux, respecting border security, respecting humanitarian law. So I wouldn't say that Europe is abdicating. Europe is going through a difficult situation without abdicating to its own law.
More specifically, on refugees, asylum seekers, and this veritable explosion that the world is witnessing in enforced migration, the EU, as you say, has been busy implementing this European agenda on migration, focused on the relocation of asylum seekers and managing migration inflows. Can you tell me a little bit more about that agenda?
Sure. The migration agenda is, first one has been to, our initial reaction has been to be sure that those people, desperate people living from war, from violence, could be welcoming Europe, and no one should die on the sea, as we unfortunately see happening in the Mediterranean. So we had a humanitarian response, so we tripled our presence at sea. Certainly we operate in contrasting the people smuggler, and we have to abide by the international legislation, basically the 1951 Convention on Refugee, with the principle of non-refoulement. Basically, you cannot send someone back if he's escaping from war and violence. Certainly, there's been a question also to make a difference for those who are genuine asylum seekers and others, refugees who might have might be migrants, economic migrants, who might have other reason to come to Europe. And that is the big difficulty. We have so saved people in the sea. We have brought those people when appropriate on the European shore. We have created these hot spots, which is those centers where the people are welcome, but at the same time they are screened, they are fingerprinted, and if they ask for asylum seeker, if they are asylum seeker, they will go through the process. And if they are recognized asylum seeker, asylum refugee, they can enter the EU. If they are not, they have to go back. Of course, we need also to send people back. We need also to have a cooperation with the country from those people are coming. In the case we have difficulties in a country like Syria, we have difficulties in country like Libya, where there's still the government or national accord. At the same time, we have made sure that the resettlement, so the question is also Europe is based on principle of solidarity and responsibility. So it is the responsibility of those countries who are on the borders, in this case coming from the south, is Spain, France, Italy, Malta, Cyprus, and Greece. They are responsible to secure the frontier, but there's also a question of solidarity. So the other members should help them to shoulder the burden. So that's why the idea to relocate part of these people in other countries. We have also launched the idea to create a European Coast Border Guard, which is a process that is a proposal the Commission made last year. We hope to get it through by this year. So at the end of the day will be more responsibility, more solidarity, more hard and control, but without changing our legislation on asylum seeker. I understand it might look difficult from an outside point of view, but you have 28 member states who have to respond to their own public opinion, the parliament, and if the new legislation has to be introduced, like in the case of resettlement or quota or the border guard or any other measures, each government should go in front of its own parliament and say, I have to do my share. And you need also the support of the people. We have 28 independent and sovereign parliament, plus the European Parliament. So our governance is quite complex. Mm-hmm. And in an area of migration, we saw that the competences of the European Union as such were limited, and a lot of responsibility was in the member states. How we coordinate in the same way the work of 28 member states is a challenge. That's why the European Union is an extraordinary model of governance that allowed member states to find a common point of view, a common legislation. And I'm confident that with the months ahead of us, the situation will become more normal. We'll be able to face this refugee crisis that, again, is not generated by us, by the world in which we live.
Ambassador, the European Commission has also been working to secure agreement for the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, TTIP, by the end of the year. Advocates say that it will harmonize regulatory standards and help companies to do more transatlantic business. Critics have been warning that it's going to weaken environmental and consumer standards. What's your take on this?
If I may do a little general point, and this was also responding to our critics during the financial crisis, that Europe was looking inward, there was too much busy with its own internal problem, was far from being true, because we have launched quite an ambitious trade agenda even in the midst of economic crisis. And the TTIP you mentioned was launched in 2014. So Europe has always had and will continue to have an open trade agenda. Certainly this is the most ambitious agreement we ever had, we ever have a launch. That will be the first and the second economy, depending on the number you. For us, we are the largest economy in terms of GDP than the US, but in any case, that will be the biggest ever bilateral agreement. Our commitment is, of course, to make the agreement at the highest level. And there's a commitment on both sides, on the US and our side, to look not the minimum denominator, but the maximum one. And that's why the negotiations always are complex. So to those critics who say we will lower the standard, not just me, but certainly the negotiators say this is not the case, because we have the mandate. The Commission had, before entering into negotiation, need to have a mandate from the 28 member states. And if you look at the mandate, you find nowhere a mandate where the Commission is tasked to lower our standard. On the contrary, we have to fix our standard at the highest level. And I think this is the same commitment by the US side. Of course, it's the biggest ever negotiation also because it's the 21st century FTA are no longer about tariff. That, as you said, about regulatory framework. And to put together all the stakeholders in this exercise to harmonize the standard of security, safety, food control, labeling, etc. You need to involve all the agency at the federal, sub-federal level. So it's a very complex agreement. We hope that we will get a deal by the end of the year. But of course, negotiators are those who can give us more updated information.
Climate change remains top of the political agenda in Europe and much of the world, and the EU's been a vital contributor to global progress on progressive carbon targets and action. Where do you see this heading in the coming period after the Paris Agreement?
We're very happy with what happened in Paris, which is for the first time the whole international community came to a common understanding that climate action need to be taken. In Paris, it's the French say it's an impactful debut, just a starting point for a process which will goes in the future. But it's a process with a clear objective. It's a process with clear review clause every 5 years, and there's a commitment by all the big polluters to be on board. And we particularly appreciate that a country like China has played an important role in securing not only its own position, constructive position, but allow other countries to have a positive approach there. The European Union has started its own climate action already 20 years ago. It's not by chance that we are now only the third big polluter after US and China, because we have already very stringent legislation since at least 15 years. And our message to the negotiation has been climate change needs to be tackled, because climate change is a reality, the science tells us. But at the same time, we said the climate and economic climate action and economic growth are comparable, it's not a zero-sum game. So you see that you can grow, you can reduce emission. There's no contrast like that. I think this message passes through, and I think the for us right now will be how to bring the whole European family, the whole global family, in this long journey. We have to provide assistance, we have to provide financial means to mitigate, to update, especially the vulnerable countries. But if you look in New York only last week, the signing of the agreement has been universal, and from what I understood, the last universal signing was in 1992 when the Convention of the Law of the Sea was signed. So basically, after 24 years, this is the most striking deal ever signed by the international community.
Australian Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull has recently underscored the utter centrality of innovation to the Australian economy and its engagement with the region and globally. This continues a long discourse in this country about innovation, stretching at least as far back as the Hawke government. Former Prime Minister Paul Keating had spoken about the need for Australia to become a clever country. And obviously now, in the wake of what's happened to the resource boom and its aftermath, Australians are looking to think about how we can be innovative and in novel ways. Of course, Europe and the European Union has done innovation, and it's done it in spades for a long time. What, in your opinion, have we got to learn from the EU and through this partnership between Australia and the EU? How can we best prosper with this focus on innovation?
Difficult to give lesson to a country and to a sitting prime minister. What I say that is that this policy of NISA, the National Innovation Strategy for Australia, that the government has launched last December, is very much welcome, I presume, not only in Australia, but certainly also in Europe. Listen, in the terms of bilateral relation between the EU and Australia on innovation, we like to say that Australia has been the first non-EU country with whom we signed a scientific and technological agreement in 1994. So when we were looking outside Europe and outside the larger Europe, let's say including Switzerland and in Norway, in 1994 we signed an agreement with Australia, which means already Australia 20 years ago was in the mood to have an international cooperation with us on science and technology. Right now the buzzword is innovation, but I believe the concept is there. So in those 20 years we had a good relation. We have instrument, we have a financial and regulatory system to increase this cooperation. And so we haven't been very much surprised by this NISA, even though it's been very, very positive that the government put the innovation at the forefront of the agenda. For us, especially in the wake of the financial crisis, when we have made the 2014 budget, we don't have an annual budget in Europe, we have a seven-year budget because of as much, this has been an invention of the former president of the Commission, Jacques Delors. They said it's impossible to have that time there were still 15 member states, it is impossible to agree every year on an annual budget. So we spend half of a year to negotiate a budget. So let's have a longer period budget. We agree with the idea to have a 7 years budget, which is 1% of the European GDP, is 1 trillion euro over 7 years. So when we made our last budget, it was 2014-2020, the current European Union budget, we decided to invest on policies that can create growth and opportunity. And that's why almost 80 billion euro, which is 120 Australian billion dollars, have been put on innovation through our flagship program Horizon 2020, because we thought, and we believe, we are convinced, that innovation can create growth, and growth can create job and opportunities. So for us, innovation is one of the main policies, together with trade, for example, how to promote trade. Trade as an engine for growth. The prospect is the same. We've already been working with Australia throughout the last budget. We already have 80 nearly so project finance, moving $300 million dollar on under the Horizon 2020. We are sure that with the new emphasis on coming from NISA, this cooperation can further increase.
Ambassador, the EU-Australian Framework Agreement, there have been various developments with that. Can you tell me what's been happening?
The meaning of this framework agreement is to look at, in a broader sense, in a wider sense, on the many track of cooperation we had between developed between the European Union and Australia in the past now 54 years. So it's 54 years that we entertain diplomatic relations. So we have started in the past with those policies which were the core of the European Union, agriculture. We mentioned before innovation, trade, investment, but the relation has grown in parallel of the growth of the European Union. Right now, Australia and European Union talk about foreign fighter in Syria, climate change, counter-terrorism, innovation, and so on and so forth. So the framework agreement is to bring all this cooperation to put it in a document in a, but it's not a paperwork. It's a treaty put everything under a single understanding that European Union and Australia are two like-minded countries, believe in rule of law, upheld the rule-based international system, and they are ready to work in a different forum from G20, bilateral, in the UN, OECD, in any other forum with this mindset. And this agreement has been negotiated for 5 years. Always, there's always some detail to be fine-tuned. We expect the agreement to be finalized and initialed and signed by the ministers this year. And after, we expect the agreement to go through the parliament, the 28th parliament in the European Union, the Australian parliament, and the European Parliament. So there will be a part of the check and balance from the parliament, the usual ratification process. So for us, is bringing the cooperation in it at the treaty level will be the first time with a political objective.
Ambassador, a broad question about your time in Australia. You've worked with different administrations at the interesting political times. You've seen changes of prime minister, changes of government, and also at a more local level, I have got to know you in my capacity as executive director of the Hawke EU Centre. You are regularly visiting Adelaide, and I know indeed, along with South Australia, the other states, your engagements are quite extensive. Just some reflections on your time here in Australia, and perhaps looking ahead, what you most hope to see in terms of the development between the EU and Australia.
Let me say that I have always appreciated your personal work, the work of the EU Centre. The Hawke Institute is part of our public diplomacy strategy to let the European Union known in Australia. I'm based in Canberra, the federal capital, but certainly in a federal country like Australia, everybody need to get known, to known, and to a multiplier in the different part of the community. I'm very happy that here in Adelaide we have yourself, your center, who are doing a great job to promote at least the understanding of the European Union, to have a public discourse on this. Certainly, I arrived here on the day of the 2013 election. I landed in Canberra on a Sunday morning. I went straight to my office. I wrote the first cable with the result of the election. Certainly, I've been coincide with a vibrant political dynamic in Australia. Not something that surprised me coming from Europe. Political life is always vibrant and dynamic. For the future, what I would like to see certainly is the treaty to be signed. Another very big, very important initiative. We have the launch of the free trade agreement between the European Union and Australia, which is an unprecedented breakthrough for the two. We have European Union is the first investor in this country, is the first services partner, and the second overall trade partner. So we have a big say, I would say, in the prosperity of this country, so we would like to contribute more. Certainly, any ambassador would like to leave any great legacy behind. This is for me too early. I need to remain humble. I need to remain down earth. Still, more than 1.5 years to go before leaving. But certainly, the objective will be to leave a stronger relation between the European Union and Australia, a better understanding of what the European is going through, and certainly putting in motion initiatives that can further grow, like the leadership forum between the EU and Australia, which has been launching this year, which is will be a public platform to bring all the stakeholders together. And I hope that initially, together with the EU Centre, the FTA, and the framework agreement, will give max successor and a great future.
Lord Anthony Giddens, in his award-winning book *Turbulent and Mighty Continent*, argues that the future of the EU depends in large part on its ability to transcend what he calls paper Europe. I want to read you something from Giddens's book. He writes, "Paper Europe consists of a host of future plans, roadmaps and so forth, drawn up by the Commission and other EU agencies. Many, however, remain just that, aspirations that cannot be fleshed out and made real because there are no effective means for their implementation. Paper Europe isn't the same as bureaucracy, although it overlaps with it. The point is not its procedural nature, but the fact that ambitious schemes and proposals are drawn up which remain largely empty." Ambassador, is he right?
But with all due respect, I don't think he's right. Certainly he's quite a sophisticated critic than other who bluntly...
An advocate.
Certainly Europe is a complex governance. Nobody would believe that Europe is an easy thing. But if we are able to make a little distance ourselves just for a second for the current affair, we can see that in the past, since the 1951, when the steel and coal community was established, till 2016, Europe has experienced an unprecedented period of peace and an unprecedented period of sheer prosperity. Mm. Certainly, we have to never be complacent and say that business as usual. But Europe is an extraordinary project. Is a reality. Sometimes the people believe that we are in an ongoing experiment. An experiment always gives you the idea that can finish. I think Europe is a reality. And if you see what happened in Greece, somebody might thought that what happened in Greece could not have any effect on the other country, but in reality had, because we share the same currency, we share the borders, we share the budget, we share diplomats, we share a lot of policies together. So we are much more than a spelling, we are a reality. Of course, in this troubled world where we live, financial crisis, terrorism, sectarism, migration flux, certainly Europe cannot believe that its own model is able to face any challenges. No, we have to adapt our challenges. And this is why in Europe, especially in Brussels, they always say never lose the occasion of a good crisis, because with the shaping the EU facing the external challenges, you have much more realistic Europe able to face our challenges with the new instrument. Certainly, the critics will never be happy. The critics will always say that put the onus on the proof on the European Union. But we are already entering the post-Westphalian system already since the end of the Second World War. I don't think nobody would want really to come back to the idea of a single member state able to coping with these troubled times. Certainly, we need to adjust to find more the policy who are more close to the citizen, could reply to the need of the citizen. But unfolding the project, I don't think it's is possible nor desirable.
The critique that the Union has not put down strong enough emotional roots among its citizens is not only advanced by Eurosceptics, but actually by some pro-Europeans. In Germany, the distinguished political philosopher and sociologist Jürgen Habermas, well known for his pro-European stance, has recently argued that the monopolization of the EU by political elites risks reducing a sense of civic solidarity that's actually crucial for the very success of the European project. Habermas wrote in that article, and I quote, "According to the scenario I propose, civic solidarity will have to include the members of each of the European nations. Only in that case would the EU citizens who elect and control the parliament in Strasbourg be able to participate in a joint process of democratic will formation reaching across national borders." Habermas's work is I think fascinating because it speaks both to the academy, but he engages the broader publics. What do you think of that point that he makes, that what the EU needs to do is to go that step further and actually engage more of the emotional commitments of its citizens?
It's a complex question, and the point made by Habermas is certainly an important one. There's always been a big debate on do we have a European demos or we don't. Is the Europe have a democratic deficit or not? Certainly, in a democratic society, it's rarely that you find the citizen particularly happy of their own government. I think any under latitude, you always have a sense of distance, dissatisfaction between elite and people. Mm-hmm. Certainly, the European Union, as it says, is an complex system. They certainly have distance from the citizen, but we have an internal system of check and balances. All the legislation the European Union passes need to go through national parliament, need to go through the European Parliament. Every treaty which has been created, European Union, has been ratified unanimously by member states. When somebody made the referendum and say no, we had to rewrite the treaty. So there's a system of check and balances within the Europe to keep the citizen informed. Certainly is not enough. Certainly we can do more. But I wouldn't say there isn't the citizens and there's not a commitment there. I mean, I believe that if we are standing together 65 years later in the middle of the crisis, because at the end, at the core, everybody feel, most of the citizens believe there's this is a good idea, this is a project that still stands valid, and there's a strong political commitment to continue forward. Certainly, there's political forces who are not happy, that give the Brussels all the fault, all the sin of what's happening today. But if you look outside Europe, around the world, you see a quiet distance between people and politics. You see populism rising under any part of the world. So I think we should be put the critics on Europe, which is always legitimate, in a wider context of the relation between the citizen and elite all over the world under any latitude.
The final question I'd like to put to you goes back to the Giddens book, Turbulent and Mighty Continent, which comes from a speech by Winston Churchill. Let Europe arise, urged Churchill in a speech which this year will see its 70th anniversary. With all of the global shocks that you've mentioned and these challenges, arguably everything that could have been thrown at Europe now has been thrown at the EU. Are we perhaps at that point where the EU is transcending all of these challenges and following Churchill's recommendation, it really is now about to arise?
I think you're referring to the speech he made in Zurich in 1946. Certainly, it's a lot has been thrown at us. I don't know if it's the end or not. Certainly, we take it as a challenge to reply to our critics that our system can progress. And if we look at the global challenges that we talked before, terrorism, climate change, refugees, we believe that staying together, keeping the family together, will allow us to progress. So I think it's Europe has become a global player. I don't think we will never have fixed the Iranian nuclear program without the European Union. Mm. I don't think we will ever fix climate without the European Union. I don't think the WTO will ever born without the European Union, and so on and so forth. It's not just to revendicate and a paper role. This is reality. If you go in any international fora, there's always in Europe and outside Europe people looking at the European Union for leadership on human rights, on rule-based system. So is European Union is a player, is a player for good. We have our own approach, we have our own weakness, of course, but we are a force for good. So when Churchill said, let Europe rise, we have reason, we are a player, and we're doing our part in this troubled world in which we live at the moment.
Ambassador Sem Fabrizi, thanks for joining us on Hawke Talks.
Thank you very much.